Our speaker this evening was therefore an obvious choice, and I'm honored to introduce Serenella Iovino, a pioneer in the emerging fields of new materialism and the environmental humanities. Her work combines an attention to Italian-specific ecologies with a rigorous rethinking of materiality in the context of post-constructivist and post-humanist philosophy. She is a professor of comparative literature at the University of Torino and the founder and coordinator of the International Research Group in the Environmental Humanities. Professor Iovino's publications and affiliations are too numerous to list, but I'll limit myself to naming some of the more momentous. Her books include Eco-Criticism in Italy, Ecology, Resistance, and Liberation, which was published with Bloomsbury in 2015.
Next year, actually. Oh, okay.
It's coming out in 2016.
Yeah.
We have a form, you can order it this evening if you like. Also, Ecologia Letteraria, Una Strategia di Sopravvivenza, with Ambiente in 2006, and Filosofia dell'Ambiente, Natura, Etica e Società, with Carocci in 2004, as well as Material Eco-Criticism with Indiana University Press in 2014, which she co-edited with Serpil Opperman. She's also contributed chapters to such volumes as The Bioregional Imagination, Literature, Ecology, and Place in 2012, and Thinking Italian Animals, Human and Post-Human in Italian Literature and Film, and International Perspectives in Feminist Eco-Criticism. She's also published numerous scholarly articles in international journals. Please join me in welcoming Serenella Iovino.
It is not easy to speak after this introduction. I hope I won't be disappointing you with my actual presentation now. And I thank you very much, Rebecca, and I thank Claudia for this amazing and welcoming moment. And to be here with you and with all of you, it's a real honor for me. And something which I hadn't expected, because being invited in such a prestigious by such a prestigious institution in such a prestigious and ancient place is really something that it's very rewarding for those who work in our field. So thank you very much. And today we will be speaking about Venice's bodies, and we will see these bodies as ecological texts, as you can see from the title of this lecture. This presentation, this lecture, comes from the second chapter of my forthcoming book, Eco-Criticism and Italy, in which, in a way, I take Italy as a bodily text, and I interlace the body of Italy with its landscapes, its living beings, its inhabitants, with literary text and artistic text. So today, our text will be manifold, as you will see. And we start with, of course, the title of this lecture. So, Death in Venice. From Wordsworth to Thomas Mann and Luchino Visconti, this trope has become commonplace in the cultural imagination of this city. But, like all literary clichés, also this one hides a more complex reality. In this lecture, I will not merely focus on death in Venice as a literary subject, but on the embodiments of this death, on its materialization in the many living bodies of this city, its biome and ecosystem, its landscape, its human residents and workers. All these bodies tell stories, stories of elements and of natural dynamics, as well as stories of cultural practices, political visions, and industrial choices. They tell stories of life, but also stories of pollution, exploitation, and death. Using eco-criticism as a framework, we will read all these storied bodies as texts, and we will read them in combination with literary works. My thesis is that diffracting this bodily and literary text with each other, namely reading them in mutual combination, is a way not only to shed light on the hidden plots and meanings of a reality, but also to amplify the often unheard voices of this reality. Every time I describe a city, I am saying something about Venice, Marco Polo says in Calvino's Invisible Cities. Venice is, quote, a first city that remains implicit in all the other. Our view is complementary to this one. Venice is our case in point, but implicit in our discourse are all the places where the balance between nature and non-nature is precarious and where this instability becomes an issue of justice and health. In Venice's translucent story, we can catch a glimpse of many other places, near and far, from Bhopal to New Orleans. But before we come ashore in Venice or in any other implicit place, let us briefly see what ecocriticism is. As one of its pioneers, Glenn Love, has written some years ago, teaching and study literature without a reference to the natural conditions of the world and the basic ecological principles that underlie all life seems increasingly short-sighted, incongruous. The world in which we teach and study literature, the world in which literature is made, is the same world in which humans, along with several millions of other species, live. What physically affects this world affects all the activities happening in it, including our intellectual and cultural production. This is something which sometimes we forget. Ecocriticism is an incitement to consider culture not as totally apart from nature, but to see nature and culture, word and text, as mutually permeable. Practically, this can mean many things. For example, it means to examine how literary texts mirror or elaborate on the ecologies, plural, of the outside world, how they culturally respond to the crisis affecting these ecologies. But it can also mean another interesting things, namely that the world itself becomes a text in which these crises are scripted. Landscapes, ecosystems, and bodies are here read as text expressing the interactions of human and non-human actors. When word and literature combine, like it happens in the case of Venice, the whole expressiveness of reality is enhanced, and we are able to see more. How does all this relate to Venice? Venice is an exercise in hybridity. It is so not only because it mixes water and land into a new elemental combination, creating a city out of 100 of little islands suspended in a lagoon, but also because it is an act of hubris, a violation of ontological pacts. Of course, amazingly creative one, we must add. Everybody loves Venice. It is undeniable, however, that the volatile balance of this combination creates here an incumbent state of danger. Not only is Venice exposed to its amphibious nature and to all the natural consequences of climate change, it is also exposed to decades of polluting practices due to political and industrial choices, which proved to be abstract from this complex reality. You can see, this is still Venice, just like this. The crisis of Venice is therefore the story of a misinterpretation of its material text. When choices such as the building of Porto Marghera's petrochemical factory were taken, the text Venice, in other words, was read in isolation from its context, in isolation from its ecosystem, its history, its elemental natures. The story of this misinterpretation is narrated by documents and bodies. It's written in cells and legal files, in industrial sludge and algae, in a landscape transformed into highways of pipes, in the air transformed into smoke. In this lecture, we will read material stories and literary stories through each other, trying to restore the meanings of Venice's ecological text, providing a narrative framework to this complex and often contradictory textuality. Literary texts have a power, the power to reveal unspoken connections and to disclose the artfully enclosed elements. In so doing, they help us to make sense of a reality that too often appears as a fragmented and incoherent picture, impossible to understand. First, the first textual approach to Venice begins with a plunge into its remote nature, its geological unconscious, to quote the poet Andrea Zanzotto, that we will encounter again in this lecture. So I invite you to try to imagine, also thanks to the help of these pictures, to imagine the things that I am narrating now, because this is a story, and so try to picture these things and try to see all these things together with you, with your eyes almost closed if you want. So, text one, Venice. Let's read this ecological text. The text of Venice is a hybrid one. This hybridity refers in the first place to its amphibious constitution. Venice is situated inside a lagoon, a mobile site where the blending of fluvial and saline waters determines unique evolutionary conditions. Extended over 340 square miles, Venice's lagoon displays a rich and delicate web of biodiversity, also due to its distinctive microclimate. Temperatures here are 2 degrees Celsius below the average of the Mediterranean. This determines a phenomenon called Atlanticism, also characterized by the existence of a flora and fauna more similar to the Atlantic than to the Mediterranean ones. Not easy to imagine that we have a corner of Atlantic in this northeast region of Italy. The lagoon has a special feature. It breathes with the moon. Tides are the expression of this breath. It is easy to picture the steady coming in and going out of waters as a breath of the lagoon, which inhales high tide and exhales low tide, like a lung, literally. Expanding with the incoming air, the lagoon increases its surface with the incoming sea. Of course, it is exactly a breath, because when a lung is suffocated, of course, you cannot breathe properly. And this is what we will see happens to Venice. You have to imagine the lagoon exactly as a lung. The way the lagoon looks like today, it's rather recent. Its current hydrogeological conformation dates back to 2,500 years ago. Egyptians were already in decline, so just to have an idea. We need to go way back in time to see the Venetian lagoon originating from the melting of a vast ice gulf, which connected Grado with Ancona. Grado is here, Ancona here. So it was from the Slovenian borders to, say, here. So the Alps with the central Italian Apennines. At the end of the last ice age, so 10 millennia ago, the glacier waters started flowing to the Adriatic Sea, forming rivers that carried huge quantities of sediments. In the course of thousands of years, the heaviest sediments fell on the lagoon bed, hardening into a very compact, solidified clay called Caranto. Caranto comes from a medieval Roman word which means stone, so it's a rock, actually. So the clay hardened so strongly that it was just like concrete. The remaining sediments accumulated, contributing to the formation of a multitude of little islands. Venice's core is all this, 100 sedimentary islands covered with a unique vegetation of reeds and other plants lying on a firm and thick Pleistocene ground. Even though the terra firma was already populated in the Neolithic and in the Bronze Age, it was not until the 5th and 6th century AD that the first settlements over this land sea started appearing. The settlers were mostly fishermen, trying to escape the attacks of Visigoths, Huns, and Lombards, nomadic populations coming from the northern forests of Europe. Looking for shelter, these inland people began to make their abode out of these tiny islands, connecting them with wooden bridges and creating canals. It is in these canals that Venice's blood flows. But these veins required a skeleton too. The fishermen started digging wooden piles into the muddy seabed, driving them until these piles reached the Caranto, this rock. Underwater, surrounded by salty mud, in oxygen-free environment, these 25 meters long oak trunks mineralized. They literally petrified, becoming as hard as concrete, as hard as the Caranto itself, thus providing the perfect foundation for the world above. It took an immense quantity of trees to make this urban forest of buildings, as Zanzotto again named it, and to turn this place into what Goethe called a beaver republic. When the primitive palafits became houses, palaces, streets, a generous part of Europe's forest had joined the Caranto in this watery underworld to resurrect in the form of a city. Venice, La Serenissima, for centuries one of the most powerful city-states in Mediterranean Europe and in the world. What is clear here is that the city results from the cooperation of many forces, human and non-human. These forces interact in a hybrid compound, forming hybrid collective stories. Venice is thus a text written by human and non-human makers, to use Jorge Luis Borges' term. And so Borges pictures this collective making of Venice. So literature is always something which tells us how things really are. And let's read how Borges describes Venice and its origins. Rocks, the rivers whose cradles lie in the mountain peaks. Those rivers' waters blending with the waters of the Adriatic Sea, the cases and phases of history and geology, riptide, sand, the gradual formation of the islands, the proximity of Greece, fishes, migrating people, the Armorican and Baltic worlds, the reed huts, the branches mixed with mud, the inextricable network of canals, primeval wolves, the incursions of Dalmatian pirates, the delicate cotto, terraces, marble, horses, Attila's spears, the fishermen protected by their own poverty, the Lombards, being a site where west and east meet, the days and nights of forgotten generations, these were the makers. All these were the makers of the text Venice, a text that had been written and carefully interpreted by generations of citizens and governors. Let me show you this, because it's a beautiful picture, and you find here the delicate cotto, so we don't need that quote anymore. So, before we go to the next slide, I think. What is a lagoon? A lagoon is, as we have said, an amphibious ecosystem, whose unstable balance is due to the combined action of two concurrent forces, river waters and sea tides. River waters are responsible for carrying sediments to the sea. If this force, the force of rivers, prevails, the fate of lagoons all over the world is to become, in the long run, land. If tides prevail, lagoons become bays or gulfs. For over 1,000 years, the Venetian lagoon was able to keep its peculiar condition thanks to the wise management strategically carried by the Republican government. So there is nothing natural in Venice. This is the triumph of artificiality. But the way this art combined with the conditions given by natural forces and elements is peculiar. So I'm trying to say that there was a way to read Venice's text, which was an interpretation, maybe a correct one, if one wanted to preserve the lagoon, which actually resulted in the existence of this beautiful work of art and nature that Venice represents. So, for over 1,000 years, the Venetian lagoon was able to keep its peculiar conditions thanks to the wise management strategically carried by the Republican government. This form of wisdom was a sensible interpretation of Venice's material text. The public authorities and institutions read it as a lagoon and acted accordingly, thus seconding this Faustian dream. This is actually the dream of Faust. The sensitive interpretation of the lagoon's text lasted until 1797, the Treaty of Campo Formio, when Venice and the greatest part of its territory were given by Napoleon to the Emperor of Austria in compensation for the Netherlands united to France. Under the Habsburg domination, many portions of the lagoon were privatized. They were either transformed into agricultural land or turned into fish farms. Almost one third of the lagoon was thus subtracted to the free expansion of tides and fluvial waters, and even more damages were inflicted by lowering the level of the canals connecting the city with the lagoon and by enlarging the harbor mouth. Finally, the creation of groundwater wells for industrial use caused the ground level to sink even deeper. So it's a very unstable balance, that of the lagoon. And all this accumulation of, abstract intervention over its text were actually a misinterpretation of this text itself. At the end of the 19th century, bridges and railways were also built. In the early decades of the 20th century, the decision was made to install a huge industrial plant in the Porto Marghera area, here too with deeper canals to allow big cargo ships. This, as it is easily imaginable, has contributed to expose Venice to the force of high tides, amplified today by the unstable dynamics of climate change. And so the lagoon, from a living space, has turned into a scenery. In this beautiful setting, the very foundations of the city are shattered every day by thousands of boats and ferries and by the humongous cruise ship that dreadfully dock in San Marco Square. So they see it as a scenery, not as a living landscape. Another picture that you might want to have a look at is this one, which was taken actually at the end of the 70s. So today the situation is much worse than you can see in this old picture. Well, let's go to the second text that we want to read after the natural one. The text number two is industry. Not so many among the millions of tourists that you have seen in the previous picture that every year invade La Serenissima know that in front of its magnificent beauty there is an eerie satellite, an anti-Venice. This satellite, or rather this planet fallen into sea, is Porto Marghera. Here, the futurist dream of an industrial Venice that would finally erase, quote, the putrefying body of the cloaca maxima of passeism, as Filippo Tommaso Marinetti named it, materializes in 18 kilometers of navigable canals, 33 kilometers of docks, and over 2,500 hectares of industrialized peninsula. But let us re-evoke Marinetti's vision, at once a dream, his dream, and of course, and a curse against Venice. Let's go. I think we can go back to this text after we have read, after we have listened to this one.
Noi siamo cittadini, provata massima del spazzatismo. Vogliamo guarire questa città, crescente piaga magnifica del passato, rianimare il popolo veneziano decaduto, morbidizzato, avvilito, preparare la nascita di una Venezia industriale e militare che possa dominare il mare Adriatico, grande lago italiano. Apprezziamoci dunque a colmare i piccoli canali puzzolenti, bruciamo le nostre poltrone a dodo per cretini, innalziamo fino al cielo l'imponente geometria di fonti metallici per abolire le curve cascanti di vecchie architetture. Venga il regno di divina luce elettrica a liberare Venezia dal suo penale chiaro di luna da camera mobiliata.
Bravo! Pippo, Tommaso, Marinetti.
I think that we don't really need a translation, but here we have one. So Marinetti wanted to repudiate the old Venice. We repudiate the old Venice, enfeebled and undone by centuries of worldly pleasures. Repudiates the Venice of foreigners, a magnet of snobbery and universal imbecility, the cloaca maxima of passeism. We want to cure this putrefying city, this magnificent sore from the past. We want to prepare the birth of an industrial and military Venice. Industrial and military, strangely enough, always together. Anyway, we want to prepare the birth of an industrial and military Venice that can dominate the Adriatic Sea, that great Italian lake. Let us hasten to fill its little reeking canals with the ruins from its leprous and crumbling palaces. Let us burn the gondolas, rocking chairs for cretins, and raise to the heavens the imposing geometry of metal bridges and factories plumed with smoke to abolish the cascading curves of the old architecture. Let the rain of divine electric light finally come to liberate Venice from its venal moonlight for furnished rooms to let. Too bad. Bravo was actually a very nice commentary. But actually, after Marinetti and his companions pronunciated this fantastic speech, they were actually beaten by the people in Venice. So they did so in a outside a theater, if I'm correct. But the reception was not so good to them anyway. So there was not so many people telling them bravo. Okay, so after Marinetti, what happens? Let's see. An industrial and military Venice, a Venice plumbed with smoke and embellished with the imposing geometry of metal bridges and factories. This idea might have titillated the literary creativity of the city's administration some 50 years later, if in the land use plan of 1962, still valid in 1990, we can read the same reckless and categorical spell. You can read it here. The industrial area of Porto Marghera will chiefly contain those plants emitting smoke, dust, all health impairing fumes in the atmosphere, releasing polluting substances into the water and producing vibrations and noises. This is not a literary piece, this is a law. So Marghera was chiefly containing these plants ever since 1917, and it was also there that the military part of the story was written. The factory, indeed, had been a production site for hyperite, the infamous mustard gas used by the Italian army in Ethiopia and Libya in 1936, in spite of the Geneva Protocol of 1925. Italiani brava gente. But the peaceful 1960s were the years in which industrial production boomed. This was a time of expansion for the petrochemical that, after merging in a new company named Edison, will soon become Montedison, a multinational corporation participated by Monsanto and Union Carbide. Union Carbide is famous for the Bhopal's accident. Certainly, in these wealthy years of well-mannered tycoons and enlightened working classes, ecological or merely aesthetical concerns were not part of any political agenda. Obviously, the whole existence of the petrochemical comes at an astounding cost for the general health of the lagoon. Incredible amount of toxic waste are produced over the decades, in spite of the denunciation of people, workers, environmental association, and notwithstanding systems of rules meant to protect public health. For example, the dumping of toxic pollutants such as sludge from the production of aluminum, zinc, sulfuric and fluoridic acid in the lagoon was a systematic practice in Marghera. We're not talking about pounds, we're talking about tons, thousands of tons every day. In 1984, it was documented that every day and for at least 20 years, some 4,000 tons of phosphogypsum, I don't know how to pronounce it, phosphogypsum, it's something very bad anyway, had been poured into the sea. This reckless practice ceased, at least officially, only in 1988, but for some years that sludge continued to be processed and used as the basis for construction and road making materials. So, maybe it was no longer dumped in the lagoon, but streets were made out of it. After that date, another fate now, many of those pollutants were illegally dumped, guess where? In Africa, or clandestinely sank in the Mediterranean Sea. But the whole production process was, of course, extremely dangerous for the workers. In his important memoir, entitled La Fabbrica dei Veleni, The Poison Factory, the magistrate Felice Casson, which was, sadly enough, was not elected as Venice's mayor just a few months ago, Casson has demonstrated how the chief executive officers of Porto Marghera did their best to bury all the medical evidences related to the actual toxicity of the chemicals produced in the factory. In the name of a real secrecy protocol between the world's major petrochemical corporations, the risk of contamination for workers and residents, not only workers, also the residents, was generally undermined, if not completely denied. I call this a form of cognitive injustice, a crime against the people's right to know and to decide according to what they know. Because they didn't know exactly what was going on, so they were not given the choice to decide about their own fates. Marghera tells, therefore, a story of irresponsibility, deceit and stubborn denial. As you can see here, many stories interlace in Marghera. Story of cross-national interests, as you can see, many petrochemical corporations, a story of war because of the production site for hyperite and all these chemical weapons that were used in Italian's colonial world back in the 30s. And of course, it is also a story of deceit. What you see in this picture is really gloomy, and of course, you can shiver, because this picture was taken the 10th of July 1944, and this is the Royal Air Force dumping bombs on Porto Marghera. So you can imagine, Porto Marghera was an important target during the war, and so and Porto Marghera is just a few miles, 2 miles from San Marco Square. I don't think that further comments are required here. So these stories interlace in our story. Cross-national interest, story of war, and story, of course, deceit and stubborn denial. But the story coming for the workers' bodies was different from that told by Porto Marghera, Marghera's CEO. And to hear this story, it was sufficient to listen to the voice of the cells. This is not just a metaphor. As the biosemiotician Wendy Wheeler notes, our social life, our work, the hierarchies we are placed in are, quote, written in our bodies in terms of flourishing or illness. In terms of our biology, the coupling of environment and body is, quote, a form of conversation, a kind of narrative of conversational developments. In this conversation, the human body, in its immune, nervous, and endocrine systems, elaborates and keeps the memory of the many not me which it encounters, says Wendy Wheeler. This memory is elaborated by ourselves and shows itself in pathological forms. So the CEO could, of course, deny something, but if one simply needed to listen to the voice of the cells of the bodies of the residents and workers of Porto Marghera, and it was written, everything was happening there was written there. However, in spite of the voice of these cells and of that of the World Health Organization, that in 1973 declared the carcinogenicity of petrochemical substances, the production in Marghera continued for more than two decades, until a trial was finally commanded in 1998. The accusations were little things, such as mass murder, environmental disaster, mass culpable homicide, missing workplace safety, water and food poisoning, and the construction of illegal waste dumps. With a shocking sentence, though, in 2001, all the defendants were acquitted. In 2004, the appeal court reversed the verdict, sentencing five executives to serve 1.5 years in jail for culpable homicide. The supreme level of justice finally confirmed this sentence. See, even though it might appear a very little sentence, I mean, 1.5 year, it's for culpable homicide, it might be really nothing compared to what was happening there. It's a historic sentence because it is actually one of maybe the first sentence in Italy for environmental crimes, and this was instrumental to command a series of other trials that were based on this sentence. So this was, after all, the Italian and European industrial dream. But this dream was, unfortunately, absolute. It was completely disconnected from the textual evidence of reality. Marghera and all the Margheras of the world are the price paid for this dream of absolute industrial narrative, a narrative without words, actually, we could say, with a peculiar detail. Marghera is not in the desert. It is upfront Venice. It is Venice. It is Venice's body. And now, with these elements in mind, let's go to the reassuring realm of literature. And the third text is about literature. So, Marghera is Venice's body, we were saying. And in May 1911, Thomas Mann finally touches Venice's body. He will give this experience a literary elaboration almost immediately thereafter, publishing Der Tod in Venedig the following year. Much has been said about this work. In the context of our reading, however, two are the main points to which I would like to draw your attention. First, the fact that Mann's novella is a story about bodies, whose micro-category is Venice's body itself as a hybrid and collective organism. Secondly, the fact that that death in Venice, Mann's novella, is also the story of how discursive falsifications of Venice's bodily texts generate forms of cognitive injustice, culminating in death. So we try to read the reality and this literary representation through one another, and we will try to see what comes out from this intersection, or better, diffraction. Venice's body, we say, the meta category that Venice's body represents. So Venice's body is Aschenbach's body. You can see here, these frames are taken from Luchino Visconti's movie La Morte a Venezia. Venice's body is Aschenbach's body, an aging, decaying, unquiet, embellished body. a dirty, sweating, sublimely dying artist's body. But Venice's body is also Tazio's body, an unspeakably beautiful young body. In this beautiful body, the germ of decay resides for the very fact that this is a living body, a biologically determinate matter. Every living body is sub specie aeternitatis, a corpse. So therefore, biology, of course, contemplates beauty as a moment, not as a fixed eternity. But Venice's body is also all of this city's bodies. Its dirty streets and white Istria stones, its seabirds and sandbanks, its brackish waters, its people. They are all caught in the triangle of space-time matter on which biology depends. Here, the decadent aesthetics inhibit any idealization of Venice's landscape. In his iconographic imagery, rather than Canaletto, as you can see here, we sense Guercino, et in Arcadia ego, also death resides in Arcadia. In fact, Venice is not a setting here. It is not a picturesque landscape, but a corporeal presence one can smell, feel, touch. Venice possesses here an uncanny and pervasive agency which becomes fatal when another actor enters in the mix, cholera. But this fatal ending is not due to a combination of merely material condition. Here I quote Mann, "The city was diseased and was concealing it out of cupidity." You can take this sentence and put it in Marghera's story and it won't make any difference. Indeed, death in Venice is the story of a sanitary emergency and of the fraudulent way the city's authorities handled this emergency. Cholera is caused by a number of coalescing factors: environmental conditions, the climate, poor hygiene, etc. Little, however, is the way, and I quote Mann again, "corruption in high places," end of quote, "covering the danger mingles with all these agencies, thereby amplifying the explosion of the epidemic. That what really strikes us, however, is the way information is deliberately manipulated and the truth artfully disguised." Let's see this quote. "The Venetian authorities issued a statement to the effect that health conditions had never been better. Fear of the overall damage that would be done, concern over the recently opened art exhibition in the public gardens, and the tremendous losses with which the hotels, the shops, the entire multifaceted tourist trade would be threatened in case of panic and loss of confidence, proved stronger in the city than the love of truth and respect for international covenants. It made the authorities stick stubbornly to their policy of secrecy and denial." So, what happens here? In front of the materiality of danger, a falsifying narrative provides reassuring discourses so as to disable the alarm without really neutralizing the bomb. The echoes between this story and that of the petrochemical factory are hard to overlook. I am not alluding here to any bizarre mimicry between art and life. What I mean here is that literature combined with the material texts of reality provides a theory to better understand these texts. If we read literature and reality through each other, we might better recognize recurring patterns, in our case, a game of unheeded material eloquence and pursued discursive deception in which cognitive justice is completely nullified. As Belle Epoque travelers become disposable resources for an economic system feeding on tourists, so Porto Marghera's workers taste the violence of an abstract, wordless, and indifferent industrial narrative. But by providing a theory to better see reality, literature transforms reality itself into its own narrative. It gives us the tools to really recognize these dispersed dynamics that we encounter and to which, for which we don't have names. I think that what the importance of Mann's novella, of his story, the story he tells, is actually to give us a framework in which to in which we can read all these dynamics of cognitive injustice. And so, in a way, literature provides a theory to better see reality, transforming reality into its own narrative. This is also something that other authors do. And in particular, I would like to examine two of them, a poet and an actor and a dramaturgist, Andrea Zanzotto and Marco Paolini. Zanzotto tries to transform reality into its own narrative and providing tries to provide this theory to better see reality by offering a poetic reading into Venice's invisible natures and also wounded bodies. Paolini, on the other hand, does it by socializing these wounds and turning them into a performative memory that can be shared, cognized, and reenacted. By the way, for those who don't know, Marco Paolini is the one that was pronunciating Marinetti's spell against Venice. So, Andrea Zanzotto. One of the major European poets of the 20th century, Zanzotto takes Venice as a recurrent subject of his work. Like his poem Fu Marghera, his prose Venezia Forse, on which I concentrate here, perhaps Venice is the title, strips the city of its picturesque aura and gives it back to its weird life, a strange, quasi-zombie life in which destructive and vivifying forces coexist along with the discordant fates of the city's storied body. Venice's inner ambivalences, he suggests, require a different way of thinking Venice. Comprehended from the distance of an elsewhere, so Zanzotto, Venice appears as a whole around a universe in which the idealized pictures make way to the material complexity of a monstrous ecology. So we are here, quote, in a world of crossings, a precarious eternal dimension where the Adriatic Sea shows, Zanzotto again, its nature of poor pool now thickened with sludge, where the purest mother of pearl blends with the shady rainbows of industrial dejections, where, again Zanzotto, pus and petroleum, phosgene and worms, incompetence and vain ambition are fact. End of quote. To accept Venice's double nature, this being splendor and decay, means to go past its meta-narratives, whether of absolute beauty or industrial progress. Like industrial progress, beauty for Zanzotto is not absolute. It is not disconnected from the materiality of its object. Hence, it implies decay, corruption, and death. And this is what happens to Venice. So try also to visualize this quote. The most distressingly strident couple in the world. Venice fastened together with Mestre Marghera. Which one is the living? Which one is the corpse? All of a sudden challenges you to a salvaging suture through the obscenity of the real and of the present. It challenges you to move further toward a never seen where even evil could be stopped, emptied of its power and rehabilitated as a sign, a trace, a form. This is a very important passage where even evil could be stopped, emptied of its power and rehabilitated as a sign. So, like living body and corpse, the mother of pearl blended with industrial dejections, matter and antimatter, Venice and Marghera, this anti-Venice, are one and the same. To see Venice means to see this living monstrosity. But if we really want to move further, we have to transform mourning into cognition and develop new ways of seeing that stop the evil, as Zanzotto demands. We have to transform wounds into socially shareable signs, into narratives. So even more than novels and poetic prose, theater can contribute to socialize these wounds. One of the most original and engaging Italian playwrights, Marco Paolini, is the author of a number of plays enacting what he calls teatro civico, a civic theater. In these acts of narrative resistance, a collective civil memory is reconstructed as a necessary operation of cognitive justice. So we have to find ways to narrate these stories, and theater is a very, very effective one. Paolini's Parlamento Chimico, Storia di Plastica, Chemical Parliament, Plastic Stories, 2001, is about Porto Marghera. Based on an impressive amount of data, the play includes historical documents, the workers' medical records, legal files, scientific and technological descriptions of the production processes, and many personal stories of people living inside or near the factory. Here again, the narrative agents are material. The factory itself emerges as a body. Paolini portrays this body as a naked body, so naked that one can almost picture it through X-rays. Looking into this organic nudity creates a new porn, an industrial porn. Naked factories that, when the lights are turned on, let you glimpse their circulatory system, the organ. This is porn. Therefore, men like it. I know of many people seduced at night by the petrochemical factories spread in the landscape. This is something that lures mostly males with all those fires, light, structures. This obscenity, however, This is a quote from the play, of course. This obscenity, however, is the same that Zanzotto saw in the ambivalent corpse body of Venice. The present, our time, for Paolini, like for Zanzotto, is obscene. All this is obscene, not because it reveals too much, but because it hides what should be showed. Paolini connects facts and framework into a narrative civic memory and thus creates a great game of mirroring and resonances within the naked and wounded bodies of reality. So it's really a mirroring game between narratives and bodies. Performed in front of an audience of workers, which are themselves ecological texts on which this story is written, of informed citizens and of common people, Paolini's plays echoes realities indefinitely, and in so doing, it produces multiple reverberations of meanings. It connects all these people with all these places and with all the pieces of the puzzle. So you can see, Paolini's play was not actually performed in a theater, it was performed en plein air in Venice, and also in another industrial setting, Castiglioncello near Piombino, another industrial, sadly famous industrial setting. And so he could actually use his audience as a sort of mirror of what he was saying. And so everything was part of the performance, the setting, the audience, the narrator, and there was a game of interlacements of stories, which actually amplified the meaning of what was being told. So, literature here is helping reality to perform itself and its interconnectedness via the story, the stage, and the audience. This is a practice of civil resistance and narrative liberation. Put on stage in Venice in 2003 during the carnival and right after the second sentence of the Marghera trial, Chemical Parliament is the story of a political failure in front of the eloquence of matter. As Paolini said, The language of politics do not include the admission of failure. Its narrative art is conventionally structured as to always tell things in terms of defense, consolidation. But who shall tell failures if no politician will care to do it? Well, Venice's bodies do, if we read them as ecological texts, combined, of course, with literary texts. And literature does it too, in combination with these bodies. Literature does it by transforming evils into signs, thus liberating the hidden voices of this reality. Grazie and ciao. Venetian World. Yes. I have more pictures to show. These pictures come from Fulvio Reuter's book on Venezia, Essere Venezia. This is the book. It's a classical book. All right.
Thank you for this rich and very interesting presentation. Thank
you for the talk. And I saw this talk at the University of Virginia about a year ago.
Yeah. Good. So
it's nice to see you again. I was just wondering about the port and how the situation is now. Whether there's a trial still going on, or what state is this disaster? Is a lot of work still to be done, I imagine.
Yeah. Actually, not so much has changed in the last 12 months, but what has changed is the mayor of Venice. Last year, Orsoni was in jail. This year, is no longer the mayor, but we have another mayor who, unfortunately, in my opinion, of course, I take on full responsibility of what I say here, Felice Casson is not the mayor of Venice. Felice Casson, as you have seen, was the magistrate who was responsible for this big, important, momentous, historic trial against the petrochemical factory. Today, actually, the problems of Venice are not so much the industrial problems, because, of course, the petrochemical factory doesn't exist anymore in that form. It was, of course, closed after this trial. Today, there is still an industrial production very, very, very much reduced compared to these golden years. And actually, the workers are this industry is in crisis, so is in a crisis. So, of course, now the workers have different problems compared to the problem they were having in these years. Now they have mostly economic problems, and of course, the curse of these illnesses is always the same. So it's very slow, as you can see. So of course, there are still residents and former workers of Porto Marghera that are still paying the price for that industrial narrative without a word that we were actually seeing in this talk. But of course, today Venice is a puzzle of many different problems. We have seen this picture of the big cruise ships, and of course, in spite of the protests of the population and of all the, petitions that circulate, actually, there is no way to stop this big cruise ship from actually docking in San Mark Square, and this is really something which it's destroying and will. I mean, I don't want to appear as a Cassandra, but this is something which, in the long run, is not going to do any good to Venice. So it's something which is a real harm. But even though it might also not appear so bad, also the traffic of little boats, it's dangerous to Venice, to the foundations of the palaces. So this water power is very dangerous, also because we have here a combination of natural dynamics, subsidence, and eustatism combined with this human activity. So subsidence is, of course, the sinking, the progressive sinking of the territory, and eustatism is the rising level of the sea. So we did this, of course, have natural but also human-induced causes, and all these things combined together. There is not simply one cause for one problem. There is a combination of factors that, of course, are intertwined and react together. So today there is still the trial for corruption to this, there is a corrupt, it's very complicated anyway, the system of electromechanical dams called MOSE actually today is one of the most important parts of the discourse about Venice and about the way we can manage high tides. But this is also a very important source of corruption. And of course, there is a trial still going on now.
Thank you, first of all, for your speech, which was so rich and passionate and provocative. So many things come to mind. And first of all, naturally, I think I am the oldest in this room. I've lived through many seasons, at least living, among the living people in this room, not about.
There is much and, life that we don't see.
But, and so through many seasons where the, let's say, industrial development tried and failed to reconcile with simply decent lives, you know, decency of. So I would even suspend the judgment or anything because it seems to me that I don't see so many. I haven't seen so many, not only in Italy, so many comforting experiences of this possible reconciliation. I'm an optimist. Maybe it will come, but every time I see the reconfirmation that it seems almost fatal, that the industrialization is a destructive force. And I don't want to give up, I don't want to surrender to this sad conclusion, but I think the reality is quite discouraging. But what I wanted to say about what you said about the juxtaposition of contraposition between Venice and Marghera, for some reason, once I was almost trapped, we missed the train with my wife in Mestre, and that was quite an experience, actually. But at the same time, what I was thinking, and I don't want to be so long, Marghera and those type of places are, how can I say, you said that very, very, very well, are places of denial and secrecy and deceit. They are a lie under so many aspects. But the, can I say, the beauty of Venice and the beauty of our, as we say, città d'arte can be a lie too. This is the most disturbing thing, because Venice is a city which has been losing inhabitants for years so far. I mean, nobody lives in Venice anymore, and so Venice is the extreme example of this degeneration. But even in Florence and the other beautiful cities that we possess, fortunately, in this country, since you deal with ecological problems, and this is a manageable problem. I think the problem that we have in our hands is to make the fruition of these cities truly ecological, and this is possible. I think it's not too late. But certainly the way people consume Florence today is not ecological. It's a lie. It's a lie, because that is not Florence. And I think this, I don't know how much this is commonly shared as a problem, when the objective is always to have more and more tourists, and almost like una variabile indipendente compared to the rest of the factors of our lives. So my final question is, if you contemplate in your future studies, or if you have already dealt with some sort of ecology regarding the fruition of what is positive of the beauty of our country.
Of course, it is out of love for this beauty that, of course, the concern comes. And actually, the things you have said are, I think, the perfect counterpoint to the kind of discourse I really wanted to make with my lecture today, which is, as I said, one of the chapters of this book I just delivered to Bloomsbury. But yeah, there are so many things that represent conflict, represent contradiction. And of course, you mentioned industry and the conflict between industry and health. Actually, industry or industrial development originally has a liberating power, because oil has a liberating power. If you talk to a peasant of the 18th, of to the Middle Ages, of to the I don't know, undeveloped countries, of course, to have a to have machines is liberating for actual toil, because it actually saves you from dying after all this the weight of this extenuating work and labor. But of course, there are, as you say, consequences that have very, very bad effects on the quality of life. Of course, when you say that all this beauty that surrounds us is a lie, of course, because I agree with you. I agree with you in a certain respect, because the way this beauty is presented to the market is a lie. Everything that we do, everything that we experience in our ordinary lives, is actually happens in on the background of a big lie. This big lie is, of course, the lie about the sustainability of our economic lifestyles, of our lifestyles every day, actually. So what we do has consequences that we mostly ignore, and many people ignore. But of course, the kind of literacy that we need is a literacy that opens our eyes in front of all these hypocritical attitudes toward reality. So actually, what we can do, I mean people working in educational institutions, for example, intellectuals or educators. What we can do is trying to actually lift the veil and try to show that there are actually more genuine ways to approach reality as an ecological text. When I say ecological text, maybe this might be not a felicitous expression, but I just want to say that reality cannot be pictured in one dimension. There are so many interlacing dimensions in reality. One of these maybe most quoted expressions of ecological culture is Barry Commoner's first law of ecology. Everything is connected to everything else. I don't know, maybe to say that and to prove this one life, ten life wouldn't be enough. I don't know whether this is an empirical reality, but it is true that so many things are interconnected, and the way we approach reality as an ecological text is simply the way to try to see as many connections as possible. And since we are, let's say, humanists or post-humanists or eco-humanists, but anyway, we are human beings producing human culture, I think that we might also use, and I'm not afraid to say use, we can instrumentalize some of the beauty we produce, for example, in literature, and we can try to transform this beauty into a tool to allow, that allows us to better read these ecological texts of reality, texts that are actually in which we ourselves are included. So, therefore, reading Thomas Mann today, I think that can say much, much more than it did, for example, when it was written. In 1911 or in 1912, death in Venice had a meaning. Today, this beautiful or this classic of European literature can have more meanings, and we shouldn't be afraid to use these cultural texts as tools to better read the ecological texts of reality. But as you said, this is exactly the way we can actually dismantle these false narratives. So we have to really go toward a more genuine or a more dispassionate or passionate interpretation of this reality. There is a beautiful book that came out after I had written this chapter, so I'm very, very sorry I couldn't include it in this conversation. And this is Salvatore Setti's Se Venezia Muore, If Venice Dies. In that book, of course, differently from what I try to do in this chapter, but also Setti's employs the idea of losing the memory of what, for example, something like Venice is. So, and Venice, again, is a metaphor for other realities. Of course, we take cities as examples, we take some cases as examples, but we can read other realities, of course, through this kind of framework. And to go back to the final part of your question, which was my favorite part, and now I'm trying to squeeze everything in this little time which is left, positive reactions or positive cases. Yeah, I am very, very lucky because I live in Piedmont in a splendid place called Cuneo, or the Cuneo area. Splendid place, Cuneo. Maybe sometimes one doesn't think that there might be something beautiful in that part of Italy, simply because we don't know Italy so much. So I didn't know Cuneo myself. I come from Naples, so therefore, the only things which I had in mind when I was hearing the name Cuneo was Totò, Antonio de Curtis, so the actor, saying, I've spent 6 years as a military in Cuneo. So that was, Cuneo was the outer space. But actually, this place is experiencing over the last couple of decades, a resurrection. This was an abandoned place, a place of poor agricultures, a poor agricultural area in which agriculture was simply, in which industry was superimposed to agriculture. And so, but it was a place almost abandoned. But in the last couple of decades, something has changed, and these places are now resurrecting. And in fact, last year, the vineyards of Le Langhe, Barbera and Monferrato, Cuneo area, the Cuneo wine landscape has been included by the by UNESCO as a World Heritage. It was the 50th. World Heritage Site. So this is, I think, a very important example of how really to being able to read places in their combination of natural and cultural factors can help them to enhance what they can do. And so I think that there is still hope, but we have to make a big effort. This big effort is to be honest and just to try to tell not to tell so many lies, so about what we experience every day. Thank you.
Hi, fantastic lecture.
Thank you.
So I'm not very learned on the concept of reading cities as ecological body or as ecological texts, but it's a fascinating idea. Are there any other notable areas where this has been done? Like, I had just heard of this through Venice, but, like, are there many places around the world where scientists and professors are studying this?
Well, actually,
the eco criticism of it.
This is something that, thank you. I mean, when you say you're not so literate about reading places as texts, of course, I don't think that this is a widespread practice of interpretation. We are trying to develop this. Since everything has been said, everything has been written, we try to invent something else. But I try also to be a little bit fair toward reality, as our friend was saying. But this is a methodology of interpretation which, along with other scholars, with other eco-critics or practitioners of the environmental humanities, I'm trying to develop. So this is something that we call material eco-criticism, and it's the way we can combine the study of literature to landscapes or bodily realities. And of course, it's not simply something about semiotics. It's something about the way these material realities interlace with their representations, for example, literature, but also art, also film. So everything which can create a sort of a resonance, right, between text and word. And so we try to put these things together and to read these things together. Of course, there are other scholars that do this, but we are trying to develop more and more cases in points. And in particular, I am interested in Italian cases, and this is what this book, Ecocriticism in Italy, will be about. So, but there will be soon more cases, I think, not only written by me, explored by me, of course. Thank you very much for having me here.